Recording first. This is the recording first part. Take your last drink of the night. Drink off camera.
Aged water.
Streaming. Hi, Facebook people and YouTube people and other people on the internet. This is Technorama. We will begin our regular show in just a moment because a lot of you are probably just getting your alerts right now saying, Technorama stream is live. Go there now. You'll catch us during all this unboring stuff. We have a show coming up about tech, science, sci-fi, and all things geek. In fact, that's our tagline, has been for about the last 12 years. We are coming up on our 12th anniversary very, very soon. I didn't realize that. May 1st, 2005 is when this show started.
I know. Actually, I was, I met Jack Jaffe the other night at Carowinds. I mean, yeah. I met him before, but I caught up with him. And he's doing a podcast on the theme parks, roller coasters.
Yes.
And so he was at Carowinds, which is in my backyard, and I gave him a little bit of history, rundown of some of the things I know, and it was kind of fun. He said, so how long have you been podcasting? And I said, well, actually, 12 years.
Forever.
Yeah. 12 years, which is about 11 too long.
It's surprising how many podcasts that started that long ago are still there. As T. Morris and I are updating Podcasting for Dummies to the third edition. Currently writing it. Our next deadline for the 50% mark is April 17th. We need everything done by the end of next month. And we're going through a lot of these and saying, okay, you know, there are a few that fell by the wayside, but there are a surprising amount that are still out there and still going. So we have good, stickiness, stamina.
Yeah. Well, I would also say, that it's probably pretty amazing the ones that aren't still with us, because there's a large number of those as well.
Yeah. A lot of people who originally went in and said, I'm going to make $1 million. And that didn't really happen. So Craig and I, we're just going in for the fun and experience and building a network of friends.
Yeah. Well, that's what I told Jack. I was like, he said something about numbers. I was like, you know, I don't even think about the numbers.
I don't either.
You know,
I don't care.
When I'm not having fun making this, then that's when we'll stop.
I mean, I like to look at the Facebook numbers and say, hey, how many people watched us tonight? And then I'll check it the next day and say, how are we doing, you know, relative to previous weeks? Well, yeah. that one was a little thin, and then we try and figure out why. Was there an awards show competing for the same time slot, or you know, the Game of Thrones season premiere is on? So you know, there's always factors that influence that, but thank you for joining us. If you have, John Miller Jr. is online at the moment. Appreciate that. Shall we begin?
Yeah, let me, I keep forgetting how to, I know what it was.
Bring up Facebook?
No, I'm trying
Facebook.
To.
Facebook.com.
If you click on the 2 minute thing.
The two minute thing.
I'm sorry. The post time on the post, which at the moment it says 2 minutes, but it'll say 3 in a minute. When you click on that, it opens up the window with our video.
Yeah. Hey, there's a new thing. I didn't notice this. Maybe this is new. It says watching now. Clinton's there. We can give a decent shout out to the chat room.
Watching now. Oh, yes. I see it.
That's nice. Thank you, Facebook. A feature we can actually use.
Very cool. Now, see, I wish I could see that whole pane on the left without actually seeing our video. That's just more bandwidth I don't need to waste.
Yeah, I get that. And we were talking about a bandwidth upgrade because Cox has given us a $5 thing for the next year. It's like, hey, for $5, you can get 2 or 3 times as much bandwidth. Like, yeah, then, that's download speed. I want some better upload speed.
Yeah. And then it's $70 a year extra after that.
Craig, you're going to have to learn how to spell Des Moines one of these days.
What did I say? Oh, I was in a hurry. How'd I spell it?
D-E-M-O-I-N-E.
Oh, whatever.
Des Moines. It's Des Moines.
Yeah. I was in a hurry. You said, put it in the show notes. I'm like, hey.
We got some last minute voicemail. So this is all new to us. We're going to hear it as you hear it. Let's begin the show, shall we? Enough of the pre-show banter.
Yeah.
Let's have some fun. Thanks for strapping in, everybody. We hit the old record button on this end, and away we go. Technorama episode 503. We have podcast sign.
Good morning, folks. This is your captain speaking.
Technorama.
Remember when?
Technorama.
On this day in tech history.
Tech.
And now the news.
Tech.
What the chuck?
Technorama.
Welcome to Blockhead Video.
What is that yellow brick road, and where does it lead to?
Over there, in the media corner.
Same as it ever was.
Technorama.
Hold my beer and watch this.
Unfasten your seatbelts and disregard all safety rules. Here your flight crew, Chuck and Craig.
That was funny? Not the intended meaning when you wrote that, was it?
No.
That's
it was not.
I read it as a Talking Heads lyrics.
That's did you say that?
I was cracking up at the end, right before I was reading it one more time, as it suddenly David Byrne's voice jumps in my head. Where? This is not my beautiful podcast.
I know. That's right. Yeah.
Hey, welcome to Technorama. This is a show that takes a lighthearted, and I stress lighthearted, look at tech, science, sci-fi, and all things geek. If this is your first time listening to Technorama, thank you for joining us. If you are returning, welcome back. We appreciate giving us your time one more time. I am Chuck Tomasi, and with me as always is Craig Stepp. How are you, Craig?
I am elated and happy. I'm a happy geek today.
What's up?
And we're going to talk about it in a little bit, but I got to watch the first episode of MST3K today.
Ooh.
of the new season. Yes, no spoilers. I'm not going to ruin anything for you, but I just want to give you a quick review out of my head.
Okay, and we do have in the pipeline, recorded to be produced, an interview with Grant Pachoco, who is one of the puppeteers on Crow T Robot.
Yes, and I'm going to get that out this week. So to get that out ahead of the debut of the show that comes out
on the 14th.
That's Friday.
He was gracious enough to give us some time on the 8th, which was kind of pretty fine, but you won't find any spoilers there either, because we are releasing that, like you said, prior to the release of MST3K on Netflix.
Yeah, and we didn't talk about anything that would ruin anything or...
No.
So we talked in general terms about the show, but that's not the only thing we talked about. So be sure to listen and you'll learn something new about Grant.
Friend of the show, patron, we're having a good time. Long time show. We were on his show once. I was a sound Foley artist.
I did something. I remember Floyd. I did something on his show one
you
time.
You took and pictures.
Probably. Oh, yeah. Well, I did at the live show in Ontario. Yes, I did do that.
Oh, we have feedback. Actually, I had a postcard. Did that make it in here? We got another postcard from Jorgo.
Oh.
Where was he? Germany? Did you get one?
Yes, I got one. See? Right there.
There you go. Yours is different. He likes to send different postcards to us.
You know, usually when I get those from him, I keep them around the desk for a few days, and then I'll take a picture of them.
Digitize
and put them in Evernote. Yeah, but I like keeping them around for a few days.
Mine didn't make it. It was on the kitchen table for a while. I don't know. I thought it made
Monsashu
it in here.
Monsashu der Eiffel? Like...
Yes, something about
right.
Eiffel is what I saw in there too. I couldn't read it either. We'll have to go to Google Translate. Jorga also sends us another one about U.S. terminology or phrases for non-U.S. speakers. He says, snores or s'mores, not sure of the spelling, Tootsie Rolls / Pops. So we are going to quickly explain s'mores for our non-American listeners. S'mores are, it's a contraction of the word it's some more. I want some more. So people just say s'more. It's S'apostrophe M-O-R-E-S. And it's a graham cracker. Actually, two graham crackers. You make a little sandwich with a roasty toasty marshmallow and chocolate. And you eat it up like a sandwich. It is a sugar high.
That's for sure.
I remember we were trying to teach some friends visiting from Malaysia a few years ago. And we're roasting s'mores on the fire at one of our company outings. And it was pretty funny because they stuck it in the fire and it caught fire. I mean, the marshmallow immediately burst into flames. They say, is he supposed to do that? I'm like, no, that's called lava. So then they backed off to about 5 feet away from the flame and the thing would never roast. So after about 45 minutes, we finally got the touchdown. They ate it, and they weren't really sure because it was very, very sweet. When we went inside to get some hot cider or beer or whatever it was we were drinking, we also noticed that they had the prepackaged ones from, I think it was Keebler or something. So that's the cheater way to do it. When you're tired of roasting them over the fire, you can get store-bought ones. So, also, what are Tootsie Rolls / Pop? Tootsie, I thought they had Tootsie Rolls over there. In the UK.
I thought those were pretty universal.
Yeah. Tootsie Rolls are just little chocolate,
like little chocolate rolls. Candies.
Yep, chocolate candies. It's soft.
It's very soft. It's not like a Hershey bar or anything, but it's like a very soft, almost consistency of chewing gum, but it's just
kind of.
You don't chew it. You just chew it and eat it, and that's it.
And Tootsie Pops are a candy lollipop with Tootsie Roll inside it. So you lick the hard outer center, and you get to the chewy inner.
How many licks does it take to get to the center of that Tootsie Roll pop?
The world may never know.
So well.
We have maybe voicemail, too. Yay. I forgot to even play the feedback music.
Letters. Oh, we get letters. We get your letters every day. Mailman, mailman, mail today. Reach right out and pull one out. Those letters. I love those letters.
Look, it's a postcard.
Find out what you've got to say.
Letters today is brought to you by the letter V for voicemail.
Yay!
And we have three of them from Mike from Des Moines. I almost said John. That's not right. Mike from Des Moines and Tim Elliott's in the chat room. I used to roast marshmallows by catching them on fire and letting them burn out.
Actually, that's what I do.
A lot of people will burn the outside, then peel off that crusty outer layer, and then eat the soft gooey. Yeah.
No. I'll let it kind of crust, and then put it on the chocolate, and I'll eat it like
that. Like that carbon taste.
Yeah, the carbon taste. Where it looks like, you know what it looks like. You know, on 4th of July, you have those fireworks. It's like little snakes. You burn them, and they look like they just come out of the ground.
I thought it looked more like Kilauea. Pele, the lava goddess, jumped into the marshmallow. Anyway, voicemail.
I'm caller number 9. Great. Hey, this is Mike Moy, and I'm asking all my fellow Technoramatrons to leave a message for Chuck and Craig and tell them how wonderful this podcast is. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And you have to...
Technoramatrons?
Okay. Technoramatrons. I like that. The transcript on Google Voice is even better. I'm calling on the line, Craig. Hey! This is Mike from Des Moines, and I'm asking all of my fellow techno room at Ron's...
That's right.
...to leave a message for Track and Craig and tell him how wonderful this podcast is. Thank you very much.
I love Google Translate.
Techno room at Ron's.
Yeah, right.
It's probably going, what is a technorometron? I'll just guess. Okay, another one.
Hey, Chuck and Craig, this is Mike from Des Moines again. And I called on your 500th show episode, and thank you for playing me twice, even though I didn't finish that one. And the reason I didn't finish that one is because I was going to thank you for gifting us every now and then with the blessing, and I'm losing it, and never mind. And you'll probably play this one, too. Oh, well. Have a good one.
You're welcome. You're welcome.
Hey, Chuck and Craig, this is Mike from The Blink again. These are just fun to read. These are fun to read as they go along.
I actually remember I had an idea of doing a podcast of just reading the Google Translate.
Yes. Well, this one starts out, hey, checking Craig. This is Mike from The Moines again, and I'm
The Moines.
All right, let's hear what it really sounds like.
Hey, Chuck and Craig, this is Mike from Des Moines again, and I wanted to thank you for playing my voicemail that I sent in for the 500th.
You're welcome.
And playing it more than once was even better. And I just wanted to thank you for the one that I didn't actually make it all the way through. I didn't know if I should mention it, and I regret not doing it. thank you for gifting us every now and then with the Dean Martin of podcasting, Mike Orr Menengay. Thank you very much.
Goodbye. Dean Martin.
Wow.
I don't know if he's ever had that title. We'll have to let him know.
Well, if he'd ever show back up, maybe you could tell. We could tell him in person.
He's good for about once a quarter.
Yeah. It's like he comes by for the board meeting and heads back out into the field.
How's the earnings report going to look this quarter? Bad, right, as always. Okay. See you next quarter.
All right. Good seeing you.
Thank you, Mike. And yes, we will pass the message on to Michael. I'm not even going to tell you how it transcribed his name.
Damn right.
Let's do the history thing. Where's the history button? There it is. On this day in history for April 12, 2017, this is the 102nd day of the year in the Gregorian calendar. There are 263 days remaining in 2017. It was on this date in 1606 that the Union flag is adopted as the flag of English and Scottish ships.
The Bremen, a German Junkers W-33.
Junkers.
Junkers, whatever.
Yeah, Junkers.
Junkers, I gotcha. W-33 type aircraft takes off for the first successful transatlantic aeroplane flight from east to west on this date in 1928.
That's interesting, from east to west. 80 years ago today, Sir Frank Whittle ground tests the first jet engine designed to power an aircraft at Rugby, England. So 80 years ago today would have been 1937. Jet engine. Very cool.
That's pretty cool. April 12th, 1945, U.S. President Franklin D. Roosevelt dies in office. Vice President Harry Truman becomes president upon Roosevelt's death.
That was a monumental turning point in history. I'll tell you that. Because Truman, I'm watching a series on Netflix right now by Oliver Stone called The Untold History of America. Very eye-opening. If you want to hear some good history about things they didn't teach you in history class that make you go, oh, that's why some countries hate us.
And there's plenty of that.
Yeah. April 12th, 1955, the polio vaccine developed by Jonas Salk is declared safe and doesn't cause blindness anymore.
And April 12th, 1961, the Soviet cosmonaut Yuri Gagarin.
Gagarin. History, man. This is nerd history.
Oh, whatever. Gagarin.
Gargantuan.
Because they have Yuri's Night. That's what it's after,
that's
right?
That's tonight. I mean, April 12th.
Or 12th. And becomes the first human to travel into outer space and perform the first manned orbital flight, Vostok 1.
Vostok 1. That same date in 1981, the first launch of a space shuttle, Columbia, takes place on the STS-1 mission.
And April 12, 1992, the Euro Disney Resort officially opens with a theme park, Euro Disneyland. The resort and its park, Yeah, very inventive. And the resort and its park's name is subsequently changed to Disneyland Paris.
Happy birthday goes out of this state to mathematician, soldier, engineer, professor, Germinal Pierre Dandelin. Dandelion. Born on this date in 1794.
Nikolai Przewalski.
Przewalski.
I had it right in my head. I don't know why I can't say it. Russian geographer was born on the same date in 1839.
You know, I purposely put in Russian names just for fun.
Whatever.
Yeah, Edward Walter Maunder, the English astronomer studying sunspots, was born 166 years ago today.
And Ferdinand von Lindemann, German mathematician, was born on that same date in 1852. Hey, by the way, there was a mistake in here. It said I took the word out earlier. It's a German Oriental mathematician.
No, I think that was his name.
No, it's a German.
That's the way it came from Wikipedia. I'm telling you.
No, it's a German Oriental mathematician.
Yes.
He was Oriental?
That's how it came from. It was in there.
But I went and looked it up, and I went. No, I don't see Oriental even on the page, so I took it out. Must have been some mistakes.
Maybe his name was Hans Lee.
You need to check that app you're using.
It's the API, man. American photographer Imogen Cunningham was born 134 years ago today. What an appropriate name for a photographer, Imogen.
That's right. Yeah, right. Otto Fritz Meyerhoff, German biochemist, was born on that date, on this date, on the same date, in 1884. Excuse me.
And the British automobile designer Cecil Kimber was also born on this date in 1888.
Suez Canal nationalization. Suez Canal nationalization engineer.
He had something to do with the Suez Canal.
I guess so. Okay. Muhammad Yunus was born on 106 years ago today.
That's a different way of spelling Muhammad. American writer of children's book Beverly Cleary was born on this date in 1916.
And also born in 1812, 1925.
April 12th, did I say, not 1812.
I know, I just realized what I said. April 12th, 1925, British animator, puppeteer, and writer Oliver Postgate.
Also turning 92 today is American computer scientist, designed one of the first word processors, Evelyn Barazin.
And Soviet cosmonaut and test pilot Igor Volk was born on this date in 1937.
Maybe it's Igor. American pianist, keyboardist, band leader, and composer Herbie Hancock is 77 today.
And actor, American actor, Ed O'Neill, born on this date in 1946.
Also born that same date in 1947, American comedian, actor David Letterman.
And American author Tom Clancy, born on this date in 1947.
David Cassidy is 67.
Go for
it. His name on the Partridge Family? David? No. What was his character name? I can't remember.
I don't remember
Keith Partridge is 67 today.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Looking at the listener birthdays, you know, I'm going to rewind the music in a second. We're running out. You know what? Let the music run out. We'll do the listener birthdays. That's the way it was on this day in history for April 12, 2017. We'll be right back with the listener birthdays. There we go. I didn't want to be talking with no music and then the music runs out. That's just depressing.
It's not professional.
Listener birthdays. These are people who have gone to our wiki at truckchat.com/wiki and put in their birthdays, and we give them a shout out every time at this year. And sometimes their birthdays get a little aged, like they say, "Hey, I'm turning 40," and it was 10 years ago. So they're kind of like Keith Partridge, perpetually 21. We're going to go back a little bit because we missed a couple of weeks on our show due to family, friends, and illness is what took us out the last couple of weeks. But April 4th has a couple of birthdays.
not necessarily in that order, right. And they may not all be related.
Correct. I'm sick of my friends and family. Is that what you're saying?
No. Move along.
Yeah. April 4th is Brian K. from my blog. Appropriately named. Joel McLaughlin, a.k.a. Gorkin, is also on the 4th. The 5th, we have a plethora of birthdays. Chad Davis, John Isler, Griffin Sylvester, Yorka's mom, Martine Teismans. I hope I even got that close. Ringmaster Greg from the former Dancing with Elephants podcast. One of those podcasts that didn't last.
What is he, 106 by now?
Ooh, Yorka?
No, Ringmaster Greg.
He's not older than us. His kids are probably teenagers.
I'm trying to
now.
Elicit a call from him if he's still listening. I'm saying.
Oh, good luck with that.
Yeah.
August 6th, Trevor Latecki, future geek. It means he's going to be a geek someday.
One day.
Friend of the show, PC Herring. Paul, happy birthday to you on the 7th.
Just real quick, isn't PC Herring, doesn't he have a new book coming out or something?
I heard rumors of that. I have not heard confirmation or release date.
I thought I saw something on Facebook about it. Just saying. Okay.
Keep an eye out. It's his birthday now that he's an old man. He's got to pay the bills.
I know.
Childhood friend of mine, Rob Hilton. I stole this off of Facebook. It's just April 12th was like the first friend I ever knew his birthday. And this one sticks in my mind forever. Danny Harnish is on the 14th. Mrs. Technorama is on the 16th.
Forget that one.
No, I don't.
Better not. You better not.
No, we even remembered April 8th is this past Saturday was the 30th anniversary of our first date. So I take care of the calendar. Don't worry. And finally, Scafey, a.k.a. Anthony, is on the 18th. Happy birthday to all you wonderful people. May you have a good birthday and a wonderful rest of the year. If you want to be on our birthday calendar.
Hopefully.
Yes.
We'll see you again next year.
Absolutely. That's the goal every year. We want to see you. If you're not on the birthday calendar, go over to chuckchat.com/wiki and put your name on there. We'll give you a shout out. It doesn't have to be like coming up in the next 7 days. It could be, excuse me, next January.
He's getting all choked up about it.
Yeah. Hello, birthdays. Celebrations are great.
It's beautiful.
Let's move on to the news. I had one picked out here.
Good news, everyone.
Oh, that wasn't it, but it was close enough.
Yeah.
Oh, hey, this is straight out of Oddity Central, one of my favorite websites. They have found
the they
jungle,
found?
Not the jungle boy. They no, found they the found jungle her? Girl. 8-year-old Mowgli girl found living with monkeys in Indian jungle. An 8-year-old child has been dubbed Mowgli girl after she was found living with monkeys in the jungle of India's Uttar Pradesh state. The girl is believed to have been separated from society for a long time, and she can neither speak or understand any language and gets scared at the sight of other people. In Rudyard Kipling's Jungle Book, Mowgli was brought up by a pack of wolves, but in this case of this real-life feminine version of the jungle boy, it was monkeys who provided care and protection that ensured her survival. That actually makes a lot more sense because, you know, it'd be easier to relate to monkey social behaviors than it would wolves, and wolves don't live in the jungle.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah.
The Jungle Book really mashed together a lot of animals that didn't belong in that ecosystem.
Yeah, I think so. You're right. Yep.
2 months ago, Suresh Yadav, a sub-inspector of the Uttar Pradesh Police Department, was patrolling the Motipur range of, oh man, they're really testing me on this one, Katar Niagat Wildlife Sanctuary in the jungle of Barak. Moving on.
Arash.
When he spotted a young girl surrounded by monkeys.
Hmm.
Yadav later reported that he attempted to approach the girl and investigate what she was doing so deep in the wilderness. The monkeys and the girl started screeching at him. The policeman was eventually able to drive away the primates and take the girl to a local hospital where she has remained since. That brings up interesting thoughts of, are you separating from her from her family?
Well, I kind of thought that too. I was like, okay, well, what are you going to do with her? I know it sounds funny when I'm saying it, but how do the monkeys feel, you know, being separated from her? Because they've been attached to her. So
they raised her, and she knows these monkeys as her family. You just took somebody away from their family.
Well, how do you think Tarzan felt? Yeah, the same kind of thing, right?
Yeah, Tarzan. Yeah. Craig, Tarzan was fictional.
But no, I know that. I'm just saying it's the same situation.
Similar. Yep.
Yeah.
Okay, we're going to take a quick break. Hard to believe we're halfway through the show already. It goes so fast every week. Yeah.
Here, let me go dig up some more stories we can talk about.
No, that's fine. Let's not inflict more pain and punishment on our wonderful listeners.
Yeah, there's plenty more to come.
We'll be right back with some Hacks and Strange Stories, Remember When, and Craig's going to tell us about his thoughts on the Mystery Science Theater.
Yes.
Hello, friends and neighbors. I'm your little podcast buddy, Dave Slusher. The Evil Genius Chronicles is the longest-running podcast on the internet, starting in August 2004 and continuing to this very day. It's a discussion of technology, culture, philosophy, comedy. Conversations may range from politics to comic books, from games to literature, but no matter where it leads, it's a lot of fun. There'll be songs, some interviews now and then. It's a weekly dose of audio joy, except during the dog days of podcasting, when it is a daily dose of audio joy. That's a good 80 episodes a year. And you can join the frivolity at evilgeniuschronicles.org. See you there. Excelsior!
This is Adam Savage from Mythbusters, and you're listening to Technorama with Chuck and Craig.
Dave just reminded us that Dog Days of Summer are coming back up. Dog Days of Podcasting. Yeah.
Start working on your theme now.
That creeps up fast.
I know. So start coming up with your theme there, Chuck.
Oh, theme. I had a theme. Yeah, I got one. I don't know if there's enough content to make it every day, but I got one.
Okay.
It kind of goes along with that 30th anniversary thing that I talked about a little while ago.
Okay.
Okay. What's next? Hacks and Strange Stories?
Yes, Hacks and Strange Stories.
There you go. You got the title.
Yeah.
Yay. You want to read this one?
Sure. And because this is, I don't know why I feel connected to this. Mice brains store backup copies of memories. I kind of wish I did. I don't know why I don't. So it turns out that even the human brain might use redundancy when it comes to storage. The new research out of the Riken MIT Center in neutral circuit, like it's a city or something, for neutral circuit genetics suggests that memories are stored in two places in the brain, the hippocampus for short term and the cortex long term.
Hippocampus where the hippos go to college?
Yes, it okay. is. Just stating it. Anyway, previously, the prevailing theory was that once a memory was formed in the hippocampus, it would then move to the cortex for storage. But that may not be the case, according to a paper published in Science.
Science!
Yeah. Okay. Recently, researchers called in the mice, of course, and watched a cluster of brain cells that formed after rodents were administered a shock.
Yikes.
From there, I know, right? From there, the scientists used light to control the activity of individual neurons. There are four lights.
I was just thinking the same thing.
Four lights. Anyway, the BBC, which let them turn memories on and off. Okay. As a result, the mice forgot the jolt of electricity until the memories were manually activated in the cortex. This hasn't been proven to hold true in humans just yet. It's only the one experiment, but the learnings could shape how we understand the brain disease in the future. Specifically, this might give us a chance to see how things like dementia and Alzheimer's affect the way memories are formed and stored, and devise a way to sidestep those heartbreaking conditions. Kind of interesting. I always think it's funny when they talk about, when funny as in weird, that when they talk about mice and they go, oh yeah, we were able to have it forget this. How do they know for sure that it forgot the shock?
They have little EKG things on them.
Not like you can ask them though. I mean, how do you know?
If they forgot the shock, they get it again.
Yeah. I forgot all about it.
Don't go that way.
It seems kind of weird when they say they're able to turn memories on. How do you know that?
I don't know. I don't know. I'm not a mouse scientist.
A mouse scientist.
What do they call mouse scientists? I don't know. Whale scientists are cetaceans. No, cetaceans are the whales. The
family. A rodentologist?
Well, the rodents would also include squirrels, rats, I don't know. We're off track. Let's thank our wonderful people who join us live every week.
Hey, I forgot where we were at. Check my hippocampus.
These are just lost drunk men found in waterfront bars who don't care.
Right.
These are men who found in waterfront bars who know who they are and don't care and don't drink. Anyway, I'm off on Kentucky Fried Movie again.
All right. Yes. Right.
Sunday night, 9:30 Eastern is when you want to show up on Facebook, because that's when we're around, at least most Sundays, unless family, friends, or illness are involved. Or
at least you know when to avoid us.
Business travel. Join our Facebook page and get notified automatically, and then you can join us in the live chat like a few other people. It says we got 8 current viewers right now. But when I say who's watching now, I always feel like somebody's watching
me.
Tim Elliott and Clinton are the only ones to show up here, even though I know John Miller's right there. He's making comments. Where does it say? Click watching now.
I click watching now. It says Clinton Alvord,
yeah.
John Miller Jr., and Tim Elliott.
Yeah, I get Craig, Clinton, and Tim Elliott. Kind of weird.
Wow.
Even good though, error. Yeah. So where's the other few? How does that add up to six, seven, or eight?
Actually, I'm more amazed that Clinton Alvord has 62 mutual friends with me. Wow. I think we run in the same circles there.
They're all podcast people. They're all yes. podcast people. We have Remember When stuff out there. Where is it? Where is it? Where is it? Where is it? Here it is. Yeah.
The happy-go-lucky.
The happy-go-lucky. We got to talk over that one so we don't get arrested for using it. You can make the remix. Oh, this is an article from motherboard.vice.com. It says, I surfed the wholesome web of the 1990s at this historically accurate internet cafe. Written by Ben Sullivan, who was born in the 90s. Makes me feel old. London 64 bits exhibition goes back to the future of the web's early days. He says, through an ill-fated combination of being delivered under this world in 1990 and my family not connecting to the internet until around the year 2000, I often feel missed out on huge swathes of culturally significant internet culture. But today
kind
I saw that...
Swaths. Never mind.
I've been watching lots of history shows lately.
Swathes.
They've been saying swathes, but then again, I think the narrator was British.
Okay.
But today I saw the dancing baby for the first time and I made peace with myself. Oh, I think I'd have another drink. Once you've gotten over your outrage of how and why I work at Motherboard, Web 2.0's leading cultural technology news site, ding! We can even do that for him. There we go.
Yeah, okay.
Relax and tell me about your wholesome day spent visiting 64 Bits, an exhibition to the world's, to the web's lost past, now on at London's Here East. The creation of digital archaeologist Jim Bolton, a digital director and creative firm Aesop Agency, 64 Bits is a journey from 1991's very first website all the way to the death of 1.0 around 2005, with all the weird stuff in between. And they have what look like really good condition machines, like an old Macintosh LC. And it's not that yellowish, brownish color. I don't know where they stored this thing. Running Mosaic on a Mac. It's crazy.
It is crazy.
Looks great.
You know, I imagine a lot of websites probably look better or could look better now in older browsers like that. Because not necessarily because of styles and stuff, but because everything's written more with HTML5 and standards, so it would ignore a lot of the styles and it would look better. It would look more formatted, I think.
You think now. Wait, say that again?
Today's
website would look better on an old browser?
Well, let's look at it this way.
Old sites would look better on today's browsers.
No, let me clarify my statement, sir.
I'm lost again.
Okay, so back in the day, basically you had people just using the straight HTML tags, and of course we graduated to a lot of people using Flash and all kinds of garbage, and they didn't work, especially in text browsers like Lynx, you know, off the console, or even the old Mosaic. I'm just saying now with more standards based in HTML. We're back to that more structured HTML. I think even though strip away the styles that aren't supported in these browsers, I bet these older browsers will make use of modern websites a little bit better than...
I don't.
You don't think so?
Remember, a lot of these older browsers only supported like HTML 1.0. That didn't include tables.
I'm saying that, well, tables are pretty well supported, but
not in
for
the
a long,
old original browsers. I mean, we're talking Netscape 1.0 and Mosaic.
I wasn't quite going back that far. I was thinking like, I'm thinking of my first browsing experience, which is really around 95, and the websites, you use tables, and saying
the first ones
that,
I saw didn't use tables.
Well, you know,
I'm an old man.
I'm wondering if these older browsers would do justice to some of the newer websites because of HTML standards.
I highly doubt it. They're going to run into tags they can't process.
That's what I'm saying. Some of the tags would be ignored, and you would get the structure behind it.
you'd get a crazy formatted page. It would go, all I know is the H1 bold.
And I'm going to do an experiment. Of course, you know, things like Google Drive and stuff like that's not going to work very well.
Right.
But I'm just saying, website said, I'm going to do an experiment. I'm going to show you.
Okay. You watch go and me. Pull up like Under Armour site on Mosaic 1.0, something that's highly stylized with layout. And I don't know. Did the original HTML spec even have a div tag? Because that's what most of them are based on now.
No, that was later on.
Yeah, see, it's just gonna fall apart. It's gonna look like, well, and the fact that a lot of them use style sheets now to do the styling. So without a style sheet, it's gonna look like.
If you don't have a style sheet, you should have good formatted HTML where it should look good without it. Structure. It should look structured, right? Do you not agree?
You're gonna see a instead of a nice drop down menu. For like ordering something or products or sales, go to our homepage sometime on an old browser if you can find one. Oh. And you may see some dotted bullets.
Yeah. I'm not talking about using Mosaic or the early first versions. I'm talking, you know, semi-modern, you know, fit 1995.
Imagine what's going to happen to all the client scripts that don't work either.
I don't know. I'm just saying for display, I wasn't necessarily talking about function.
I'm going to see if there's anything in the chat room to go along with this. You're going to the exhibit. Is there a big under construction sign up front?
Hey, it's a little guy going.
With the shovel.
Little gif, yeah. Or my other favorite one was the new. You know, it goes back and
the flaming logo thing. It's flaming logo. Logo's on fire. That's cool.
Honestly, okay, now I know I tried to make a point about the old browsers at least making sense of some newer sites. But think back when you first started browsing.
Yes.
And compare that to now. Wouldn't you say that the experience would have probably would you would think it would look painful?
The you difference? Mean like Craigslist?
Yeah, well, Craigslist still looks like it's...
It still looks like 1995.
Yeah, but I'm saying I think I look back on it, I'm like, oh, there were so many cool things I was doing for the first time. But then I look back and compare it to now, it's like, that was really a painful experience, some of the crap.
Oh,
and
handwriting the HTML was a pain.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, it was a pain.
Then again, and wait a minute, we're still handwriting code. Hmm.
You know what I remember thinking is, what I hated was, you saw the potential of the internet, and I knew I should be able to go search for insert subject here, and yet there were times when I couldn't find a page that had said anything about what I was looking for. And then, of course, now today, you can't find a page that, or you cannot not find a page for something you're looking for. There's a page for everything.
I thought they brought back some great memories of this. One of the screenshots they had was of Dr. Fun. I completely forgot about Dr. Fun. That was one of the first webcomics, if not the first webcomic. It was just,
yeah.
Oh, I used to read that all the time. That was a great site. I didn't even realize they went out of went down, but his goal was to do 520, weekly comics for 10 years. And he did that. He said after 520, he shut it down. So it was up from like 96 to 2006. I went, oh, I miss Dr. Fun. That was kind of like, the Far Side for the internet.
I vaguely remember that. I have to go look at it.
Oh,
it's the single panel. Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
As soon as you see the characters, you go, oh, yeah.
That's cool.
All right. Also in the history section, we have something I found interesting. I actually got lost in the video that was embedded in this article from IEEE Spectrum about the IBM 1403 printer. And it explains how it hammered out 1,100 lines per minute. This was a line printer.
And that's a lot.
Do you remember the one they had in the mainframe lab at college? It wasn't a 1403, was it? It was something else. It was close, though. It was an IBM line printer, and that thing would just go, and sheets were flying off of this thing, and it was crazy how fast these went. And this explains how it did it, and it was all a bunch of a little electromagnetic hammers that hit the letters at the right time. Now, think of how fast this is going. The ribbon is flying around this thing at, what was it, 5 feet a second, And that's got all the characters on it. So you got to be able to hit those letters at just the right time. Now, there is an embedded video in here about the 1401, which is the mainframe computer that the 1403 printer was sold with. And this was how IBM was going from old vacuum tube systems to a new one. They've got the original designers and product managers involved with this thing. And it was kind of funny because they said, we're going to make the announcement on October or something or other, 1959. And they said the only working unit they had was in the lab, and they couldn't take the lab unit and do this video. So they were doing a closed circuit television broadcast, and they made basically a cardboard mock-up of this computer for the video. He said the tape drives that you see spinning were spun by engineers behind the scene by hand. it was really funny. But
we really blew the budget on this data center.
Then they went into, they said a 1401 showed up on eBay and only one person bid on it. And they brought it to the Computer History Museum. That was the one we saw getting finished when we were there. They said they spent like 5 years on this thing. In 2004, they got it to run a basic diagnostic, and they weren't sure if anybody was, how they were going to restore this thing. So they put an obscure ad in like a mainframe newsletter that went out, and suddenly 20 people showed up, former customers, former engineers, former salespeople that wanted to contribute to restoring this thing. And they got it online and working at the Computer History Museum in 2009. We were there in 2008, if I remember right.
Yeah, I think part of the problem, they didn't have code or something to run on it.
Oh, they had to machine some of the parts. That I remember one guy, he was like elbow deep in a punch card reader.
Almost like he's trying to help a cow give birth.
It was great. So yeah, watch the embedded video on this from the Computer History Museum. It's a lot of fun. Craig, I swear, next time you and I are in Santa Clara, we are going across the street to the Computer History Museum to do an updated tour.
Wait, is that close?
Mountain View and Santa Clara are next door to each other.
Oh, man, because I was in Santa Clara. Oh, crap. I don't know.
And I'm there about once a quarter for work. So we have opportunity. We have opportunity. Yes. So a lot of fun, 1401, 1403, old printer stuff. Let's give a shout out to our patrons. There we go. Because we love these people. They fund the show, and in return, we give them content specifically for them. We record it right after this, but it comes out before this. So
yeah,
use your time shifting hats. So thank you very much to Kyle Nishioka, Mike Will, Steve Therian, Saturday Morning Media, a.k.a. Grant Pachoco, friend of the show, interview coming out soon, very talented man, Chris MC, Alexis Durant, you guys are all terrific, Ben Vaughn, Dennis Patnod, Nick St. Gabriel, Amy Bowen, Avner Braverman, Leon, some of these people have been donating to the show for a decade, it's crazy,
yeah,
John Noble, wow. Brad P. from NJ, and
see, it just goes to prove you can buy love.
You can buy our love, and if you want to do that, go to patreon.com/technoramapodcast. We need a banner at the bottom for that. I just thought of that. We need a Patreon banner. Lower thirds. Put that on the to-do list. It's in there. It's on the link on our site, on the Technorama site.
Ask Donna to add it real quick.
This version of Wirecast, lower thirds are not a real quick thing.
Okay.
I upgraded. It's hard. It's more flexible, but it's harder.
Yeah.
So we thank you very much. We got our payment a couple of days ago into the PayPal thing, and that helps offset the cost of bandwidth and storage, all the software upgrades. You know, they're not free. It takes a bit to run this podcast, and thank you very much. And in return, you get special stuff, special content. And then at the holidays, we got stuff laying around. We'll send it to you. That doesn't sound quite right, does it?
No.
So, done with that music. That leaves us with the media corner. This is an interesting one. Where did you find this?
I'm not sure.
I didn't tag this.
Welcome to Blockhead Video.
I think I may have.
Find some good information this about is music and TV and videos and things.
Over here in the media corner.
Media corner.
It's titled "Badass German Kids Show Performs Intro in Klingon." Hey kids, gather around. We're gonna have some fun today, or as we'd like to say this week, whatever it says. A popular German kids show is bringing young ensigns into the Star Trek family, introducing its latest episode entirely in Klingon. Kapla. Die Sendung mit der Maus, or The Show with the Mouse, is a German children's show that has been around since the 70s. Every episode, the topic of the week is introduced twice, once in German, and then in another language. Traditionally, it was Turkish, Spanish, or Italian. Okay. To include the children of foreign guest workers. Nowadays, the show has been introducing audience to other, more obscure languages. This week, it was Klingon. Levin L. Letir, better known as the Klingon teacher, provided the narration for this week's translation. And I've got to say, it's pretty hardcore watching the tiny mouse prance around as Klingon yells the stories of the day. I'm going to play a little bit of the audio for this just so you can hear. As the sun goes across the sky.
Captain, we've intercepted a message from Kronos.
Earth goes around the sun at a tilt of 23.5 degrees. Yeah, okay. Welcome to...
Hey, I can see it now. This is a lost episode of the Next Generation. Captain, we intercepted a message from Kronos.
This is what Wesley used to watch when he was little. Hey,
shut up, Wesley.
Star Trek kids have to watch something, right?
Turn off that, Wesley.
Yeah.
That's pretty impressive.
Throwing it up on the viewer screen.
Boy, when they said obscure languages, they picked a dandy there.
Hey, at what point, and I'm sure we probably blew past that point, is Klingon like an official, there's no official language.
There's a dictionary. Sure.
No, I'm saying, is there bigger than that? I mean, is there any
official language registry? Did a country adopt
it? No, is there an official language registry?
I don't think there is.
Or is it just,
no.
Just make them up, I guess.
I think it's just made up. Esperanto.
There's no language hall of fame or anything, I guess. So.
No, it's there. I mean, it's real. You can look it up and reference it and get corrected on it.
Yeah. I mean, well, Google had it in its translate for a long time.
Yep.
Anyway.
Okay, speaking of translations. No, wait.
Yes.
No. Geek Library. Tell us what you thought of the first MST3K of the new season.
Okay. And no spoilers, because I'll tell you, Joel Hodgson has gone out of his way to make sure that none of the movies were spoiled. Like, you knew the list of the movies. He also went out of his way to send all the Kickstarter backers an email to say, hey, please watch this on Netflix. Please don't put this on torrents. Don't leak the list. We're working really hard, you know, to make this as much of a surprise for people as they watch this. You know, as we can.
Oh, okay. So the first one, they don't really, that's contrary to what they used to do in the old days. Like, please keep circulating the tapes.
Hey,
that'd be funny if he said, put it on VHS and send it to your friends.
Yeah. That would be funny. No. So at the end of the episode, it's funny you bring that up because it did say, keep circulating the Earl. You know, and it had the
address. Nice homage to the old days.
Yeah. And I'll tell you, I read a review today that kind of sums it up. You know, when you have something like MST3K that's been around for several iterations of different places, of course, there's a lot of imitators. You don't want to be too fresh because you're going to alienate a lot of people, but you don't want to be stale and do the exact same thing at the same time. And this was a great balance of that. It was very much in the same vein. It looked like, you know, it was just the evolution of MST3K. the little sets and stuff. Everything still looks like it's made out of cardboard and stuff. It's really cool. There was a lot of belly laughs. Harrison and I were laughing, not just at the, the movie itself is ridiculous. And
did you notice the elements that Grant was talking about with the robots? He said the robots were a little more animated than they've been in the past.
Yeah. And you've probably seen this in the little trailer. So it's not a spoiler or anything, but, Servo flies around sometimes on in the theater.
Like R2-D2?
Yeah, well, he flew up on the screen and he went up and did something and came back down.
So his hover skirt actually hovers?
Yes, it actually hovers. Gypsy, I don't want to say anything about Gypsy because you're going to see that. But so Gypsy's changed slightly. I wasn't one of those people that's hung up on the voices that much. So I enjoyed the whole thing. I thought everybody did a great job. And a lot of people were like, oh, they're worried about, hey, it doesn't sound like Crow or, you know.
The voices have changed a number of times over the generations.
Think of it as
Doctor Who.
Oh, yeah.
this is 12th Crow.
Yeah.
He's going to regenerate.
I tell you what, one thing that did change, and Harrison pointed it out. Well, of course, I mean, it's obvious. But no, one thing, he liked the dungeon kind of doors, you know, that closed and had the little flames on. He liked that. But that's changed in a sense where, remember, this is all in an HD experience now.
Right.
So they had to redo these, you know, the set and everything. And I thought they did a really good job because it looks intricate, but at the same time, it still looks like
the cheesy
cardboard and stuff put together. From what I understand, Adam Savage actually was overseeing making all those little props and stuff. So I can see where he would throw himself into it and did it right. So I don't know how much he actually worked on it or what, but I think it really shows that it really matches with the show in the past. Plus it is updated enough where it's interesting and a little fresh. So yes, it's perfect. I enjoyed the first one. I thought it was fantastic and I can't wait to see the next.
Very cool.
Yeah. The movie was ridiculous. You'll love it. I'm
telling
you. Timing
for me is terrible because I've got that book deadline to work on.
I know. Well, you can reward yourself with,
At least one. I'm not going to, can't binge all 10 or however many there is.
Oh, and I was going to tell you, so Felicia Day, Patton Oswalt is in it. There's some other surprises. I'm not going to say who was in the first episode.
Ooh.
There's a couple of those. And Grant mentions a few, people that stopped by, but, you'll see those at the beginning. I thought the intro was really cool. So it's very much, like I said, in the vein of the old show, but updated to a point.
Very cool. Looking forward to seeing that. Netflix, the 14th of April is when that comes out, depending on when you're watching or listening to this. You can see it there. Hopefully you can get Mystery Science Theater in your country. If you haven't, I know that T. Morris just recently introduced Pip to MST3K.
Like, I saw that on Facebook. I was like, oh, she hasn't seen it before? I guess not.
No, yeah. Crazy.
Well, I guess the old episodes, there's a potential that you may not have come across it. So, yeah.
I have in my possession a few VHS tapes, or maybe it's one VHS tape that has a few of the original KTMA when they were on public access. They're really grainy because they've been copied at least a half a dozen times. But
yeah, and I got to go back and watch. I did watch one of them. In my account for the Kickstarter backer, I'm sorry, I'm closing my eyes because I'm trying to think. As a Kickstarter backer, we got like a bunch of back episodes, and they found a couple of them. So they got all, I think, but one episode that's lost in the ether. I'm sure somebody's got a copy of it sitting in a closet. But so they had put that in there, and he said,
cool.
It's a little rough, but there you go.
It's interesting to see how it evolved from over the years, because they didn't make,
like, all the
nearly,
elements are there, but it's all different. Yeah.
They didn't make nearly the speed at which they fired out these comments wasn't quite as rapid.
Right. And that's the thing about this one. It is a little more faster paced, and it does add to it. I think it makes it a little better.
Well, on one of the panels at Dragon Con, I think it was Trace and Bill Corbett. I don't know if it was last year or the year before. I can't remember when I was listening to this, But they said, so someone in the audience said, have you ever thought about doing a Mystery Science Theater of more modern movies? And they said, not really, because they're very difficult. The older movies, there was less dialogue and more time to inject your comments. And you can't really do that in today's movies.
They're trying to cram everything in.
I can, but you're going to have to shout over music. But
you ever watch Dragnet? The old Dragnet?
Yeah.
They're trying to shove so much dialogue in that show. They're talking like it's all very fast paced. But yeah, this show is more, a little more fast paced, and the movies, from what I've read, Joel said that they're a little more newer, but only because they're in the HD format. It would be weird having this huge screen and having a 4x3, you know,
a grainy old film.
Yeah. So I think they're all, you know, HD 16x9 movies. So anyway,
great. Thank you very much for your review. That takes us to the end of the show. We have a question for you, dear viewer, listener, before you go. If you could erase one movie from your memory and rewatch it. You got to get that second part in there. There's many I'd like to just erase from my memory, but and rewatch it for the first time. What would you choose? Right. Yeah. Let's get rid of Star Trek 5. But no, you'd have to rewatch it.
I know. No.
Share your pain with me.
That's right.
If you could erase one movie from your memory and rewatch it, what would it be? What movie would you choose? I'm curious to know what people come in with. You can call us on the listener line, 707-530-2428, as Mike from Des Moines did a few times. Or you can get a hold of us via email, technoramachuckchat.com. Leave a message. We're going to post this on Facebook also, probably about midweek, Wednesday or Thursday. And you can put your comment there with everybody else. Love to hear from you.
I'll tell you which one I'm thinking of. And I actually watched it the other day. Felicia Day was asked what movie would she like to see done. And she said, I think it was called The Wraith. And it's an old Charlie Sheen movie from the mid 80s where he's an alien car.
So
I pulled up Hulu. I actually searched for it on Google. I saw it was on Hulu. So I pulled it up. Yeah, it's horrible. It is horrible.
And she wants to rewatch that?
Yeah, I don't think it would fit. No, she wants. I think she wants to.
Oh, just said, purge it.
But do it in three MST3K.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Yeah, but I think the only problem with that is there's a little nudity in it, and you know that's a no-no for the show. So.
Right. Got to be family friendly. That takes us to the end of the show. Thank you very much for joining us on Facebook or on YouTube or in your ear holes on your mobile device later. We appreciate that. Again, you can get a hold of us on the listener line, 707-530-CHAT, 707-530-2428. Email technoramachuckchat.com, or you can find us on our website with all the other social media stuff, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube. Just go to chuckchat.com/podcast. /technorama. Wow, where'd that come from? I can't read and talk at the same time.
If you search for Technorama Podcast on any of your social sites, you'll find it.
You'll find it. If you just search for Technorama, you might get the Swiss Science Center. It's close.
Yeah, we support them.
We do. So thank you very much. We invite you once again to be our Patreon friends and give you a shout out. Till next time, binary high five.
101. See you later.
And that takes care of the recording. Thank you very much, everybody on Facebook, for joining us.
Yes, thank you very much for showing up.
It's been a lot of fun.
Oh, there I am, giving myself a Vulcan high five.